Welcome to Gender, a Wider Lens exclusive content. If you're a free listener, what you're about to hear is a preview of a bonus episode for our paid Substack subscribers.
If you'd like to hear the rest, go to widerlenspod.com and sign up for any of our paid membership options.
And to all of our premium and founding member subscribers, thank you for the support.
And here's the bonus conversation.
So we're back with Scarlet, and Stella had a great idea during our full episode. We'd like to ask you, what would you have needed when you were 12 and 13 and starting to kind of experiment with this idea of transgender,
you know, being... Honestly, I think I just needed like therapy for body image issues. I feel like I had like, what do you call it? Like, I know like they have like gender dysphoria and there's like body dysmorphia. Yeah. And I feel like that was a big struggle of mine. And I needed more help in regards to that. And I feel like it would have helped me a lot to introduce me into like some older gay people for me to just kind of see that like that's like a normal thing and I shouldn't feel so wrong and so like repulsive for being the way I was, because that just, it just led me to withdrawal so much as a kid, and I just needed like some positive role models in my life that wasn't just like, you know, my mom constantly battling against the world for me, you know what I mean? Because she really was my hero growing up. But it's kind of hard when you just have like your parent is just focused on keeping the world's prejudice at bay. It makes it hard for them to be there for you in all the ways that like you really could have used. You know what I mean?
I wonder, would you have benefited as well to have some knowledge around, you know, the online abuse, I think, might have brought in, you know, the homophobia anyway, but then also the homophobia that was, you know, everywhere, as well as the online kind of predatory behavior. No wonder you felt icky. No wonder. You know what I mean?
Yeah, because there were some very unsavory individuals that at the time I was like, oh, you know, they're my online friends. You know, we play World of Warcraft together, so it's fine. But it was not fine. And in the YouTube culture at that point, like when I was a kid, you know, YouTube videos from like Shane Dawson, all these people kind of like very much normalized like sexuality and vulgar sexual behavior between like adults and like young people is like a comedy form. So I didn't quite see it as being, you know, that big of a deal, because all my friends and I were running around, you know, repeating these obscene jokes from these YouTube channels anyways. Yeah. So we were already preconditioned kind of for these people to come along, if that makes sense.
Horrifying sense. Shane
Dawson, I'm not sure I know who that, like what kind of content is that person making?
Oh my goodness. You'll have to look it up, because I don't even know how to explain it, honestly. He used to make like, I don't know, like, you know, like the Chubby Bunny Challenge and all these like dumb kid challenges. He would like do things like that. And he just had a very like obscene sense of humor. I don't know if he ever meant to like groom kids in that sense, but back then there just weren't really any safeguards on YouTube. So he would like, you know, dress up in all these different characters and, you know, just talk really obscenely in like a comedic sense. And it wasn't just him. That was like, you know, very common at the time. That was a whole genre.
Okay.
And that was like kids YouTube at the time, before YouTube had like a kids YouTube.
Can I ask, because you're a credit to yourself, if you follow me, you really are. What do you think you need now? You know, because you're in a very challenging position now.
Honestly, some days I feel like I need therapy, but some days I feel like I've also am just better off just giving everything up to nature and just like letting, you know, life take its course. A proper medical care would be nice. I would like, you know, and I'm starting to get that now a little bit, but I feel like sometimes, even though my doctors are really honest with me, sometimes I feel like they're a little bit afraid of offending me. So some things are kind of like danced around a little bit, but I feel like they're getting to know me. Help I don't know. I just need proper medical care, honestly, would be nice. I just want to know that I'm not growing cancer, that I don't have to worry about like autoimmune diseases or any issues with my pituitary gland after it being, messed with, because that's never been checked up on, ever. So I have a lot of worries and concerns in regards to that.
And what about having a romantic life?
So I have tried that in the past. I've had very negative experiences dating so far because I tended, to attract slightly older people, and I guess, I mean, I don't know. I've just had some really bad situations the past couple of years, and I just, sorry.
It's okay.
I don't know. I've kind of like, I don't want to say I've given up on that prospect, but like a little bit. I'm kind of just like trying to come to accept, like, life can have other meanings than like romance is kind of like what I'm trying to bring myself to. Because that used to be like, my main thing I wanted in life was to like get married and have a family and all of that. But I don't foresee that as being too likely with a lot of the things that I've had to deal with, from my medication and stuff. So I'm just trying to focus on other things in life, if that makes sense.
It does.
Well, I don't want to be Pollyanna about anything, but there are, first of all, there are seasons of life, and you're just now getting your footing around what the heck has happened to me over the last, 10, 8 years. So you're in the season of like sorting things out.
For sure.
You're trying to get your footing with work. You're trying to renegotiate your position in the world. And
Yeah.
I promise that you are going to be among a cohort of people who have had this medicalized childhood.
Yeah.
And I don't have any reason to think that it will be impossible for you guys to find loving, caring, mature, compassionate partners. It's just not going to be as simple as maybe for everyone else. And even that is complicated for lots of people. But
Yeah.
I don't want you to think that, like
Yeah.
right now in your early 20s or whatever, that it's you have to make a decision for life about that, because life is long and full of interesting people will come in and out of your life.
Yeah.
There's so many ways to develop a romantic life, to fall in love, to have a life mate. There's so many ways. And
Yeah.
you're only starting out because you're just getting through a trauma. There's a lot ahead of you.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, and that makes it a little bit hard too. And I don't think it helps that I came about, hookup culture is a big thing among my
Totally.
generation. So
Yeah.
it's like people have made love into a very materialistic thing
Yeah.
nowadays. So it can be very hard to like, I guess even like really imagine like what like a healthy, like normal romantic relationship is like, because I see them sometimes, but like they're not super common, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So yeah, I guess I'm not like closed off to the idea of it in the long run, because I know life just, you never know what's around the corner, but I can't, it's not like, I guess I've just like, it's not something I'm seeking, if that
Yeah.
makes sense.
Yeah, for sure. Well, gosh, I could ask you a million more questions. Can I ask you one more thing and then we'll let you
Yeah, of
go?
course.
You mentioned that now you have some doctors who are much more straightforward and honest, but they might still be tiptoeing around you. And you also said earlier, I think in the full episode, that sometimes your doctor is very like dry and scientific and maybe lacks like the human connection or something along those lines. Like that's the implication I picked up on. So if there were doctors listening to this and they may encounter young people like you who are stopping a medical transition process or trying to figure out how to deal with their medical complications, How should they treat those patients? What do you want to share with them?
Oh, that's a really big question. That's a good question. It's a really big question. I don't know. I guess people just have to understand that this is like a really heavy decision and it bleeds into all areas of your life. And I find like a lot of people tend to like, especially among like professionals, tend to cut life up into these different categories. And you can't really put your gender or your sexuality into just like one category of your life because it all kind of bleeds into each other, if that makes sense. And I think that that's the hiccup I keep running into is it's just people with a mindset where they kind of just like put different categories of their life into these separate boxes. And they just kind of do that with me. And that's just not how I function in my life. You know, gender has bled into literally every aspect of my life. It's affected my jobs, it's affected my schooling, it's affected my, you know, romantic life, my friendships. It literally affects every aspect of your life that normal people who've never had to deal with this don't really like realize, if that makes sense. So I guess my answer is would just be like, I can't even really like say compassion because I feel like my doctor shows compassion in her own way with her openness. I feel like people just get worried about offending me because of the culture that it is today. I think unfortunately people have pushed for rights so much and it's gotten a little bit, you know, there are certain minorities that are very loud and it's made it harder for, you know, people that are a part of that minority to really seek like honest care or even like honest friendships and stuff. 'Cause like even at work, some people are afraid to talk to me or refer to me because they're so afraid of misgendering me. You know what I mean? Like it's like that bad in the culture.
Terrible.
So I think it's just a divide in mindset would be how I answer that. I don't really know like what they could do, if
They
that
treat you
makes
like a
sense.
whole person, like a whole complex
I
entire
guess to
person.
just understand that like you can't really divide your life up with all these different boxes, I guess would be my
Very
best
insightful.
advice. Just before we finish, I do have one last question. It'd be lovely. Because we met you a couple of years ago, and you seemed so vulnerable then and young, and you do seem to have grown, if you follow me, or matured in that time. It would be lovely if we're still going, which it looks like we will be. It would be lovely to see you again, because I'd imagine you'll be a very different person in a year. I'd imagine there's going to be, a lot of changes that happen. But before we go, because I know it's going to stay in my mind. Puberty and your Adam's apple, and you seem to have a male voice. So did that develop pre you going on medication at 13, or just I'm just interested. I had kind of an androgynous voice before because like even when I was a kid, I had like I had a high-pitched child voice, but I had like kind of a deep set voice, like a soprano or whatever you would call it. I think my voice is getting a little bit of like a bassier tone now that I've gone off of stuff because it used to be a little bit more like raspy and like androgynous. I can't
I
ever
think
say
it
that I have
did.
like a female typical voice, but I have like I'm very androgynous, if that makes sense. And that's just what I tell people in life when people ask, because I don't really feel like I'm non-binary, but if
I
people
like
ask, I'm
that.
like, I'm just
Bringing
androgynous.
androgyny back. Like that word has basically disappeared from the vocabulary. So I love that you're kind
Great
of
word.
reclaiming it.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's kind of the only way to really describe what's, you know, happened. And I prefer that like even over like transsexual or like detransitioner,
I
really,
think so, you're right.
because I don't like being identified with, you know, these it feels like I was just put through an experiment almost, and I don't like feeling identified. I don't like being identified by that, if that makes
Yeah,
sense.
it does.
Like I'm a whole spiritual being outside of that
Totally. Yeah.
still.
You are.
You are a
So
multidimensional person, very clearly. I mean, you are not flat, two-dimensional, and it's very hard to imagine putting you in any kind of box or compartment. So that's
character development.
well done for getting as far as you've got. You've been phenomenal.
Yeah, thank you
Well,
so
thank
much
you.
for joining us. It's been amazing to talk to
Yeah,
you.
thank you for giving me the platform to really like tell my story, because it just feels like a little like I obviously I still have to bear this burden, but it's a little bit of a weight off of my shoulders, because that silence just like you just kind of boil in it and it drives you crazy. And if I can like even just provide some nuance, because I'm not going to tell parents to make a decision one way or the other for their kids, or you know, try to influence anybody in any kind of way, but I just want to provide some nuance to people like that, to just be wary. Like, these are very, you know, powerful drugs. And, you know, take it from a kid who still doesn't know if like this was like a totally wrong or right decision. I have to go through my other, you know, biological sense to really like have that idea anyways. So you might as well just let them go through that first, and then any adjustments later on can totally still be made. You know, I know so many trans women that went through male puberty and lived a life that way and transitioned. They're beautiful now and their lives are great. You know, they might be a little bit androgynous, but like I transitioned as a child and I'm still androgynous. So like, I don't think it really makes that much of a difference, if that makes sense.
Yes.
Totally. Well, thank you. We hope you have a
Yeah.
lovely rest of your evening and thank you for
Yeah.
joining us.
You guys too, have a great rest of your days. Thank you again. Yeah.
You
Thank
too. We'll
you.
hope to have you back, okay?
Yeah,
Yeah.
definitely. I'm totally open to that. Maybe in like 6 months to a year, we'll let some life happen a little bit.
Yeah. Okay. Go
Love
enjoy
that.
life. All
Deal.
right.
Yeah.
Bye.
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 Thank you for being a premium subscriber to our listener community. Your financial support means a lot to us.
For additional ways to support the show, please visit our Substack at widerlenspod.com and click on Support the Show.
Our discussions are for educational purposes and are not intended as a substitute for mental health services. Thanks for listening.